Hi, Nicolas Vermeegh. I'm from the Thorax Center here in New Orleans, covering a wrap-up of the ACC meeting. Let's dive into the action. The meeting started, at least from my perspective, with the Apple Heart study that was well announced before the meeting, because it was introducing Apple software in medical practice. So over 400,000 patients were wearing their iWatch. And it was using an irregular pulse notification algorithm to check for an irregular heart rhythm and to identify atrial fibrillation. So a notification of an irregular rhythm was obtained in 2,000 patients that represented 0.5% of the entire population. And in 450 patients, eventually, the rhythm was also confirmed with an EKG patch. I think the data was interesting. It was intriguing because it was introducing modern everyday software into clinical practice. But what to do with it, that was not very clear from the presentation. So I think it was intriguing, but not sure whether it is already a defining moment for our practice. That is very different from the low-risk randomized trials on TAVR in patients with severe aortic stenosis at low operative risk. There were two randomized trials presented on Sunday, one by Professor Michael Reardon on the US Evolute low-risk trial, and the other one, Professor Marty Leon on the balloon expandable partner 3 data. So that was two very interesting trials that also will have almost an immediate impact to our current clinical practice. So let's first start with the partner 3 data. That was a randomized trial including 1,000 patients, one-to-one randomization to balloon expandable TAVR with the SAPIEN 3 valve or surgical aortic valve replacement. The primary endpoint was a composite of death, major stroke, and rehospitalization at 1 year. The study ended up being superior for TAVR, and that was, at least in my opinion, not expected. I was expecting a non-inferior trial. It turned out to be superior, and this will have immediate consequences. It is important to note that only patients who were eligible for a transfemoral TAVR with the SAPIEN 3 valve were eligible, and bicuspid valves were excluded. So a couple of details that were quite striking. The mortality at one month was 1% versus 2.5% in the surgical arm. For stroke, there was 0.6% in the TAVR arm versus 2.4% in the surgical arm. Death or stroke combined at 1 year was 1% in the TAVR arm versus 2.9% in the surgical arm. All these numbers were statistically significant in favor for TAVR. I think quite compelling. If you look at rehospitalization, it was 7.3% versus 11% in favor of TAVR, again significant. So very compelling data. A little bit surprising was that the mean gradient after the valve replacement seemed to be a little bit higher in the TAVR arm. That is unexpected. That was not so in previous trials. So off note of that. But then on the other hand, there was no difference in pacemakers, no difference in paravalvular leaks between both treatment arms. So quite compelling data. And it also resulted in Marty Leon suggesting that TAVR needs to be the preferred treatment for patients at low operative risk in this day and age. Something similar came out of the US low-risk study that was presented by Michael Reardon. Again, over 1,000 patients were enrolled, 1,400 patients, but this presentation covered the Bayesian analysis on 825 patients that reached the one-year endpoint. And so computational modeling was then used to determine the one-year endpoint for the entire cohort. Again, quite striking results with the mortality estimated at 5.3% in the TAVR arm versus 6.4% in the surgical arm. That was not statistically significant. But if you look at the combined endpoint, mortality or stroke at 1 year, that definitely trended in favor of TAVR. Other interesting findings from that study, as expected, more pacemakers in the TAVR arm versus the surgical arm. But then on the flip side, hemodynamical performance of the TAVR device, much better than the hemodynamic performance of the surgical arm. There was a little bit more PVL in the TAVR arm, but again, I think at the end of the day, very strong results in favor of the use of TAVR in patients at low operative risk. So I think if two trials are combined, I think it's fair to say that if you would consider a bioprosthesis for a treatment of severe aortic stenosis, you need to talk to your patients and inform him or her about TAVR. So I don't believe that it's still fair or even ethical to have a patient undergoing open heart surgery without offering the possibility or the option of transcatheter aortic valve replacement. Of course, there are several limitations to the studies. Both studies are reporting 1 year data. I think the important stuff to come is the 10-year results eventually, because then we will get an answer on durability. At the end of the day, there is no strong data on TAVR durability, but also not on surgical durability, so much more to be learned from that. And also what was quite striking from both trials, the stroke rate was so low in the TAVR arm that it makes you wonder, can you still improve the stroke rate with, for instance, cerebral embolic protection devices? So more to come for that. My personal opinion is that if I drive a car, I always wear a seatbelt, so if I would offer TAVR to a patient, I would always want to prevent and protect the brain from debris embolizing to it. So that was for the two randomized studies. There was also a TVT registry on bicuspid stenosis. Dr. Makar from Cedars-Sinai presented that study. It was a propensity-matched study comparing bicuspid and tricuspid TAVR and looking for differences in outcome. There was statistically significant more conversion to surgery, and there were some more aortic ruptures, but the numbers were low, below 1% for the bicuspids. And at the end of the day, the outcome at 1 year was similar for the bicuspid and tricuspid aortic stenosis. So again, that adds to the low-risk trials that were presented, because in those trials, bicuspid aortic stenosis was excluded. This registry seems to suggest that regardless of bicuspid or tricuspid aortic stenosis, TAVR is a very powerful treatment option. Then there was also two sub-studies from the COAPT trial that was presented last year and published in New England on patients with functional MR and heart failure. That was a sub-study on quality of life and a sub-study on echo. The quality of life analysis really demonstrated that functional MR treated by a mitral clip makes a difference. So patients are doing well, their health status is improving as compared to the control arm. In terms of the echo sub-analysis, it was a little bit disappointing. There were no clear indications that you could stratify the patients that would be responders for a mitral clip or not. So I think we need to learn more as we progress and as more patients are being studied in randomized trials to better identify the patients who would benefit from a clip in functional MR. Finally, I want to talk about two more trials. One is the Augustus trial. That was a trial in patients who had an ACS, an acute coronary syndrome, with or without PCI, randomizing those patients in a 2x2 design to either apixaban or a vitamin K antagonist, and in the other arm also aspirin versus control. So a 2x2 design, so you had patients having apixaban and aspirin on top of clopidogrel, vitamin K antagonist and aspirin on top of clopidogrel, or apixaban in combination with clopidogrel monotherapy versus vitamin K and clopidogrel in monotherapy. Turns out that apixaban compared to vitamin K antagonist resulted in less bleeding, and also the combined endpoint of death and hospitalization was lower with apixaban, and aspirin only added bleeding, so no additional benefit of adding aspirin to the combination of oral anticoagulant therapy and clopidogrel in ACS. So quite strong data that probably will help fine-tune the guidelines. It's needless, we need to say also that the patients were only randomized within 2 weeks after the ACS or after the PCI. So that means that a lot of the patients still had triple therapy surrounding their intervention. So we need to take that into account. But after 1 week, Augustus seems to suggest that there is no place for aspirin anymore. The last trial that I wanted to mention in this wrap-up is the COAG trial. This is a trial from the Netherlands where we looked into the need for invasive coronary angiography in patients who had an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest without ST elevation myocardial infarction. So patients were randomized to either immediate coronary angiography and appropriate treatment if necessary, or a more watchful waiting approach and coronary angiography later down the road. Well, there was no difference in outcome. So that is good news, so to speak, for interventional cardiologists who will preserve their well-deserved night rest. So with that, I think we had a very interesting ACC. There were more trials being presented at the late breakers, but I thought that these were the most compelling, at least from my perspective. I thank you for your attention, and I hope to see you in our next major Congress preview and wrap-up. Bye-bye.